So thank you, Nathan, for that introduction. We're going to be focusing on formative assessment today. And we'll be talking about formative assessment in sort of all the possible teaching contexts that you might find yourself in terms of whether you're teaching online still, whether you're doing some hybrid, or whether you're back face-to-face, but with maybe some social distancing involved, or maybe not if you're in certain places. I thought we could just get started by just talking about assessment in general. I've put a short definition of sort of assessment up on the slide, and I have a question for you to answer in the chat box. So I'd like you to just quickly read that definition of assessment and tell me sort of how you normally assess your students in your teaching context. So I'm just gonna keep an eye here on the chat box, and you can tell me what your thoughts are on that. There's so many people that I'm having trouble seeing everyone. So somebody said portfolio tasks, very nice. Tests and quizzes, of course. Peer assessment, very nice. Achievement board. I'm not sure what that is, but it sounds very interesting. Projects, yes, projects. Activities, great. Concept maps, I like that. That sounds interesting. All right, so obviously we're assessing our students in many different ways. And that's because it's an important part of what we do. Assessment sort of goes hand in hand with teaching. We teach something, and then, you know, ideally sort of soon afterwards, or maybe a bit later, we have to kind of check in and see how well students learned it, sort of what they remember, how well they understood things. That's a very important part of what we do. And that's one reason why it's a good topic to think about when we're heading back to school in September. So basically this session, it's going to be quite practical. We'll go through some sort of simple, easy to use techniques and activities. I thought it would be useful just to take a quick look at sort of what formative assessment is. So we're kind of all on the same page there for when we move on to the more practical part of the session later. So I thought we could start here. I think that a useful way of kind of defining formative assessment is comparing it with summative assessment sort of talking about some of the important differences between those two. These are sort of the two types of assessment that as teachers in class, we're most often sort of in touch with. One important difference between these two types of assessment is that when we're talking about formative assessment, we're talking about assessment that goes on during the learning process. This is sort of during class or sort of during the semester or course or term. And then if we're talking about summative assessment, we're talking about the type of assessment that comes at the end after students have sort of done the learning that they, ideally have done. And then we're sort of checking at the end how much they've learned. And because of because we're doing assessment during the actual course, that means that we're not measuring sort of attainment like we are at the end of a course, where we're sort of deciding whether students reach the objectives that we wanted them to reach. What we're doing with formative assessment is that we're monitoring progress. We're checking in, we're seeing how things are going in various ways. That's sort of the idea of formative assessment. And this could be a little bit more formal, like a quiz, or more informal, like simply just listening to what students while they're doing a speaking activity and then giving them some feedback afterwards. All of that would kind of fall under the category of formative assessment. And basically the third kind of most important difference between summative and formative assessment is the type of sort of information that we're sharing with students. So when you think about it, assessment involves a lot of kind of collecting information. And then we sort of process it and we share it with the students in one way or another. With summative assessment, we're giving students a grade or a mark. on something. We're telling them if they passed or failed, if they got high mark or low mark. But the type of sort of communication that we're having with students with during formative feedback is different. We're not using marks, we're not using grades. We're most often using description, what we're describing. We're talking about sort of maybe strengths and weaknesses, what's going well, what could be doing, what students could be doing better. and also hopefully giving them an idea, sort of some concrete advice about how to do better. That's kind of the idea of formative assessment. So lastly, before we move on, I just thought I would address, there's sort of other terms floating out there. You've probably come across assessment for learning and assessment of learning at some point or another. And I think for us teachers, I think we can just kind of think of them as being synonyms. So if you're thinking about formative assessment, you're basically thinking about assessment for learning. Some academics make sort of small differences between these, but for our sort of practical purposes, I think we can call assessment for learning formative assessment. So I was going to say that there are a lot of really nice resources online about formative assessment or assessment for learning. So if this session kind of piques your interest a bit in this topic, just Googling either one of those terms, you'll come up with some very clearly written sort of teacher-friendly explanations and also lots of practical ideas about this type of assessment. So, if you're interested in it, I would encourage you to sort of go out and read a bit more about it. It's a really fascinating topic. All right, so as I said, we're gonna be doing we're going to go through some practical activities. Before we do that, I just wanted to talk for a moment. I forgot about this. We're going to do an activity. Just sort of thinking about summative and formative assessment, I put up some sort of typical assessment activities up here on the board, on the slide. And in the chat box, I'd like you to identify which of those activities you would normally associate with formative assessment. So somebody wrote brainstorms. I think that's a great example. Traffic lights, very good. Somebody wrote learning journals. Yep, checklists, projects, quizzes, great. So I agree with you. I think that those ones are really the ones that are most often associated with formative assessment. But I wanted to make one important point about the difference between formative assessment and summative assessment here using these examples, because actually it doesn't actually, an actual activity or sort of assessment instrument. It's not actually sort of formative or summative in and of itself, if you know what I mean. It basically depends on how you're doing it, sort of the purpose of doing it, the why of why you're doing it. So I'll give you an example. A classic example of a formative assessment is sort of a test or a quiz where you're asking students to sort of study for something and you're testing them. And that could be quite summative in the sense that you could be doing it regularly during the course, and then you could be adding up the marks from those and then incorporating it into your final sort of grade for the course. However, quizzes could easily be formative as well, or instead. So you could be not marking them and not sort of incorporating them into the final, the student's final grade. But instead, you could be using those quizzes to kind of check in and see how well students have learned something, and sort of use that information to kind of reevaluate and maybe adjust your teaching a little bit. So maybe everybody does really well on the quiz, you can just move on. If some of the students did really well and others didn't, maybe that sort of tells you something about maybe there needs to be a bit more differentiation within your lessons, or if all of the students do poorly, that means that, you know, there just needs to be more learning involved in that particular sort of language point or skill that you're working with. All right, so we're going to be looking at a number of these activities later. But before we do that, I just wanted to just go through some of the core concepts of formative assessment. Because as I said, it's sort of, it almost doesn't matter exactly which activity you're doing, it's sort of why you're doing it, it's the purpose of it. So we could kind of turn almost anything in class into something related to formative assessment if we have the right sort of mindset for it. So the first one is providing feedback to students. And that's an important part of formative assessment. We had mentioned earlier this sort of descriptive feedback is how we communicate with our students about their learning progress, about their sort of learning journey. And in order for this type of feedback to be effective, no matter what kind of feedback we're giving them, it has to be, it sort of has to tick a few boxes. So it has to be timely in the sense that we have to be giving that feedback sort of soon enough after somebody's done something for them to be able to sort of properly reflect on it. And we also need to make sure that our feedback is clear and specific. When you're giving very general feedback, that doesn't tend to be as effective as if you're giving more specific feedback. This feedback, it really has to address more than just weaknesses. It has to address sort of strengths as well, when you think about it. We can't just be kind of giving feedback on negative things. We need to be giving feedback on positive things in order to reinforce sort of good things that are happening in class or good things that are happening in terms of the student's progress. And finally, the feedback has to be achievable. So we have to be kind of realistic about what we ask our students to do. We have to think about their level and what they're really capable of, and giving them feedback that is going to be something they can really take action on, if that makes sense. So the second sort of core principle of formative assessment is we want students to be actively involved in their own learning. So we've been talking about this dialogue, this sort of conversation that we're having with our students about their learning. And we want them, basically the goal of that kind of conversation and that sort of sharing of information in the form of this feedback is that we want students to take more responsibility for their learning. We want them to set goals. We want them to measure progress themselves. We want them thinking about sort of where they are now, where they're going, and how can they actually get there. And I think this is particularly important in this moment with so many students learning at home, because it just takes a little bit more motivation, a little bit more determination, a little bit more sort of self-reliance to keep up with our studies while we're learning at home. It's a little bit easier to sort of keep that up when we're in class, but with people learning in hybrid and online situations, the more responsibility students can take for their own learning, the better, really. And that's always been true, but I think it's particularly important now. So we've already mentioned this one about kind of using the information that we collect to adjust our teaching, to sort of take into account what we've noticed, what we've observed. And this is really the key to making activities formative. So as I said before about quizzes, those could easily be summative. You could just give the students a mark. But it's more productive and I think much more useful to use something like quizzes in a formative way, so that we're sort of taking that on board and thinking, okay, so what do I have to do differently? Maybe I don't have to do anything different, but maybe I do. Maybe there's small changes I could make or even bigger changes that I need to make in order to make sure that my students are sort of reaching the learning objectives that I've set for them or the school curriculum has set for them. And number four is that we also need to sort of recognize the influence of assessment on motivation and self-esteem. So we all know the connection between assessment and motivation, self-esteem. We've all gotten feedback that wasn't particularly constructive and just made us kind of feel bad. Or, you know, we've all done sort of badly on a test that we thought we were going to do well on. And so we all know how that feels. So assessment can be quite powerful in that sense. And that's kind of the point of making assessment a little bit more of a dialogue rather than just sort of giving students marks. Through this type of dialogue, we can really reinforce learning for all types of students, not just sort of really well performing students, but also sort of poorly performing students. In fact, there's a lot of very interesting research suggesting that sort of implementing more formative assessment within a course, it really helps lower performing students in particular. It sort of helps narrow that gap that we see sometimes in achievement. And again, I think that's particularly important now because I think that gap has sort of gotten bigger. The students that are motivated and organized and take more responsibility for their learning, they've sort of carried on. Whereas students that don't quite have those that capacity yet, they've been sort of falling a little bit farther behind than they would normally. So again, sort of implementing more formative assessment can help us make sure that those lower performing students are still there, they're still making progress. You know, they still recognize the sort of the value of hard work and determination and the sort of and what they can accomplish with those. So the last one is that students can assess themselves and understand how to improve. This is sort of related to number two in a way. It's sort of a way of getting students more actively involved in their learning. We want them to be sort of more active and less passive and have a better understanding of how things are assessed because that gives them the ability to sort of perform better and sort of keep those sort of assessment criteria that we're using in mind when they're in class or out of class doing some kind of class project. And when you think about this ability to sort of assess ourselves be able to sort of self-monitor in a sense, to sort of think about how we're doing and how we could do better. That's actually a very important life skill when you think about it. It's something that students are going to have to develop in order to do well in their sort of academic and professional careers throughout their lives. Okay, so that's me talking about the core principles of formative assessment. Before we move on to the practical part of the session, I just wanted to take a moment and I wanted you to put a number in the chat box, 1 to 5. So one would be the lowest and 5 would be the highest. So if you really understood the idea well and you're all set, that would be 5. If you didn't understand it at all, it would be more of a 1. Okay, so I see that people have gotten ahead of me. They're already doing it. Great. So I see lots of 5s. I see some 4s for sure. Okay, so there's a lot of people in here. It's going to be hard for me to answer any specific questions, but if you have a specific question that I haven't answered, you can type it in the chat box now and I'll try to catch it as it goes by before we move on. Does anyone have any sort of important sort of doubts or questions that I could sort of address right now before we move on? So I'll just give you sort of 30 seconds if anybody can come up with a question they'd like me to answer now. Okay, so somebody's talking about sort of how to do this online. We'll definitely be talking about formative assessment online during this session for sure. So we'll be doing that during the practical part. Okay, so it looks like we're sort of all on the same page in terms of what form of assessment is and isn't. Let's move on to the more practical part of the session. So I'll be talking about sort of a limited number of formative assessment activities, most of which that I've tried myself with my students. And we'll be sort of talking about how how these activities can help us improve that dialogue that we've been talking about between our students and the teacher, helping students sort of see their progress, understand how they can do better, et cetera, et cetera. Right, so here we go. So the first one I want to talk about is review. So I want to start here because it's an activity that all of us are already doing already. So all of us are doing formative assessment already. It's an important part of teaching in general. Review is a great example of that. So when you're sort of coming back to something, you're giving students the opportunity to show you sort of how well they understood it or how well they remember it. I think that review can also be an important sort of diagnostic sort of tool as well. So not only is a review activity giving students the chance to do some like retrieval practice where they sort of have something in their memory, but you're asking them to access it, which sort of strengthens the connection there. It also tells us some very interesting and important information about what our students have and haven't learned, sort of helps us tailor our teaching to our students' needs. Basically, what I would suggest is that we try to incorporate a review into each lesson, particularly at the start of the lesson. I think that's a great time for review. It's something that I've been doing for years now, sort of starting my lessons with review. I think that the key to making this kind of work in a lesson is to make it sort of simple and easy, not expect students to sort of to review an entire grammar point or an entire list of vocabulary. I think it's better to think about sort of maybe just making a small selection. So maybe thinking about reviewing 5 items of vocabulary, not sort of 15. Just taking sort of one aspect of a grammar point and thinking about how to give students a little bit more practice with it, you know, in a review activity. For example, instead of doing the whole present simple, you could do maybe just present simple questions or something and sort of check in and then see how students are doing with that. And so basically the key to turning sort of a regular classroom activity like this one into a formative assessment is sort of actually collecting some information through it and actually acting on that. So for example, if you want to take my advice of incorporating a bit of review into each of your lessons at the beginning, you could kind of have a checklist and go through that and sort of tick things off, things that you felt that the students were doing well with, and then you could maybe sort of put a circle around things that you need to come back to because students need a bit more practice with them. And so this adjusting of our teaching is sort of what makes it a formative assessment activity. Okay, so the next activity I want to talk about is called exit tickets. So we've talked about a way of maybe incorporating a bit more formative assessment into the beginning of our lessons. This would be a way of incorporating a bit of formative assessment into the end of our lessons. I'm sure many of you are familiar with this idea of exit tickets. So the classic example would be giving students sort of little cards to write on, and then they would answer the questions that you give them that are asking them to reflect a little bit on what they learned during the lesson. In sort of nowadays with social distancing and things like that, I think that maybe taking this online and doing it digitally makes a lot of sense. Obviously, if you're teaching online, you'd be doing this online. But I think if you're teaching hybrid or face-to-face lesson nowadays, I think it would make sense to use a program like, for example, Google Forms. I really like Google Forms because it's quick and easy to use. It took me maybe 30 seconds took me 30 seconds to make this example here for my students. Also, Google Forms, it gives you the ability to collect some information, and sort of Google kind of organizes it pretty well for you, so you can go through it quickly at the end of the lesson. So there's sort of different ways of doing exit tickets. The key is to keep it sort of short and simple. And one idea is called a sort of a 3-2-1 technique. So this is where you get students to think of three things that they've learned during the lesson, maybe three words, and then two words they're still maybe not sure about, and then one word that they'd like to learn. And this sort of last one could be in the student's L1. So another idea for exit tickets is simply asking the students what was difficult or what was hard during the lesson, or simply asking them what the lesson was about, just to make sure that sort of the learning objective for that day was clear. It's very interesting, actually, when you ask your students what was easy or what was difficult, because it's often not quite what you thought. You know, after teaching something, you think, oh, that went really well. But then at the end of the lesson, they say, you know, a number of students might say, oh, that was pretty hard. And you think, okay, well, you know, I may have taught it well, but that doesn't mean that I don't need to come back to that again, or I need to sort of clarify things, maybe by doing a review activity in the following lesson, just to sort of consolidate what you had taught. And one final activity with exit tickets is sort of, instead of asking students to think about sort of what they've learned, or getting them to think about sort of what was easy or what was difficult, you can actually get the students to think, give you some feedback on your teaching, on sort of the activities that you're using in your lessons. So this was an example. I was using sort of a concept map to get students to organize like the lexis within a sort of lexical field. And I just asked the students sort of how that went, if they thought it was useful. This can be a very useful way of sort of adjusting your teaching as well, because, you know, groups are different. Some groups may really like a role play activity. Other students may not sort of get so much out of it, and they might prefer to do something different. And, simply asking students that type of question, it can be a very useful way of, teaching more effectively and sort of, differentiating, thinking about our students' needs. So I'm just gonna take another glass of water here. As Nathan mentioned earlier, it's very hot in Dubai, but it's also very hot here in Madrid as well. We have a heat wave here. Okay, so moving on. There's another idea for how to finish a lesson with a bit of formative assessment. So the idea is a learning journal, and it is what it sounds like. I'm sure many of you probably have tried this already. You're basically getting students to write about the lesson, getting them to think about their learning experiences, their accomplishments, and sort of the challenges during a course. And that is, you could do this sort of at the end of each lesson, or you could do it sort of at the end of the week. But sort of incorporating it sort of regularly will give students the ability to sort of be constantly kind of reflecting a little bit on their learning. And really the audience for this is themselves. They're writing it for themselves. You as a teacher will read it at some point. You kind of check in and read it. But the primary purpose is just to get students to think about sort of how things are going, and maybe how things could be going better, and what they could be doing to get better. It's sort of in traditional face-to-face lessons, we could be doing this in like a separate notebook. So students could be writing their entries, and then we could sort of collect those once in a while, sort of quickly read through them, try to get sort of a general feeling, maybe give the students some comments, not correcting. That's sort of not the idea. We don't want to be giving students a lot of correction with that, because we want to encourage them just to be writing their ideas and their feelings and not be thinking too much about accuracy. So nowadays with social distancing and teaching in different formats, I think that a program like Google Docs is a great alternative. Basically, if you just create a Google Doc for each of the students and share it with them at the beginning of the year, then you're basically done, because those are going to be sort of connected to you for the rest of the year. And students can just kind of go through and they can put the date and they can put their entry, their date, the entry. And then you can go in and you can go to your Google Docs and you can just click on each one and sort of have a quick look through and see if there's any sort of specific advice you can give students based on what they wrote, or maybe just get a feeling for the class, sort of the class dynamic. Maybe there needs to be a little bit more speaking. Maybe students don't feel like they're getting up speaking in class or something like that. So just a note on learning journals. So in my experience, it really helps to do a bit of scaffolding at the beginning of this activity, because we can't sort of expect students to just kind of start doing it like that. Like, okay, we're doing a learning journal today, guys, go. They're just going to kind of look at you like, what are we doing? So it really helps to give students a bit of help at the beginning. And one way you can do that is you sort of give them a model of what a good learning journal entry looks like. That would be one idea. Or you could give them some sort of sentences to finish, like this one, these that I put up on the screen. Sort of however you want to do it. I think kind of introducing it gradually, helping students get the idea of it, sort of getting them on board at the beginning is important if you're going to be starting a learning journal with your students. Okay, so the next activity I want to talk about is a brainstorm. Again, activity all of us are doing all the time. But I think brainstorms can be a particularly effective form of formative assessment within a lesson, basically within a lesson, to make sort of quick judgments about sort of how to teach the rest of the lesson. And I think brainstorms are particularly effective as kind of a lead-in activity before reading or maybe before a vocabulary lesson. And by asking the students to sort of access their background knowledge of something or think of sort of the words that they already know related to a certain topic, like maybe sports, it gives you a quick and sort of easy way of seeing how difficult so the rest of the lesson is going to be. So for example, if it's a reading and the students know nothing about the topic, that's going to make the reading slightly more difficult. And so you might want to think about incorporating a bit more of an introduction to it before the students start reading, just to familiarize them with it. So they're not reading something that they're going to find very sort of just sort of different or not familiar. And the same is true of vocabulary. So if you do a brainstorm and a lot of students come up with some of the words that are in your sort of list of vocabulary items that you want to teach that day, that tells you that the class is probably going to be a bit easy and that you need to think about ways of making it a little bit harder, maybe focusing on some of the pronunciation features within that vocabulary might be one way of doing that, or possibly getting students to think about how maybe other words that they would like to learn related to that vocabulary, and that they could kind of go and look for themselves, and that sort of new lexis could be incorporated into the lesson. So just a note on sort of hybrid and online teaching. I think like many of you, when I started teaching online, I hadn't sort of experimented with a lot of these apps and programs that were already available to us. And one of them was Mentimeter. I'd never tried it before, but teaching online, I started using it quite a lot. And I think it's a really nice program for brainstorms, because basically all the students are all sort of contributing to the same brainstorm that's kind of growing as a word cloud on the screen in real time. And one thing I think is particularly interesting is that it actually makes the more frequent words bigger, so that you kind of know from a glance which of the words that sort of more students knew. And again, that gives us useful information as teachers when we're going into a lesson where we want to teach them something about the topic or something, or teach them more words related to the topic. Of course, there are other programs that do the same thing, but I found Mentimeter being a particularly interesting one to use. So the next one that I want to talk about is another way of incorporating formative assessment within the lesson itself. We talked about brainstorms as a way of sort of including a bit of formative assessment before you do an activity, so before you do some teaching. And traffic lights are a nice way of incorporating some formative assessment after something you do. So basically the idea is very simple. You just ask students to tell you how well they've understood something. And they do that by showing you a piece of paper with color. So, you know, each student would need sort of three pieces of paper like these. They would need one yellow, one red, and one green. And this is particularly effective with big classes, because with big classes, it's hard to sort of monitor each student's progress and sort of be checking on how well everybody understood something. You know, if you get all the students to raise up a card, it just at a glance, you can kind of tell how things went. You know, if you get a lot of greens, that's great. If you get, you know, a lot of yellows, you say, okay, well, I need to slow down. Hopefully you don't get too many reds. But if you get some reds, that's actually really important information to know, because maybe there were a few students who just didn't get it, or maybe they just weren't paying attention. In either case, sort of more teaching needs to happen at that point. We can't just sort of carry on into teaching something new or practicing what we've taught if students haven't really understood it. The next one I want to talk about is a rating. It's basically just an alternative. It's a 1 to 5 rating, and you know, conveniently you have 5 fingers on your hand. So you can also do this in class if you want to, instead of using the cards. Obviously online, you can be doing all of these. Actually, you could get students to just kind of show you something with color in their webcam, or show you some fingers in their webcam. I think it's maybe easier just to use the chat box, like I did for the activity earlier, where I'd asked you sort of how well you understood formative assessment. Just sort of checking in with students during a lesson. It doesn't take long. It doesn't take a lot of effort. It doesn't take a lot of preparation, but it can give you some very interesting and important information. I've been surprised sometimes. I thought, well, I really taught that well, and then I get a lot of yellows, and I'm like, well, actually, maybe I didn't teach it quite as well as I thought, or maybe the students just weren't paying as much attention as I thought they were. So we've talked about sort of implementing a bit, sort of integrating a bit of formative assessment throughout our lessons. The next idea I have for you is how to kind of integrate a bit more formative assessment sort of long-term in a course. I think that individual tutorials are a great way of doing that. Obviously, I'm sure all of you are doing tutorials at some point during the course. It's sort of a normal thing to do, maybe at the end of a course or at the end of a semester, maybe the end of a term. But I think doing it actually more often, finding ways to do it more often can be very interesting and very useful. There's nothing like having an individual conversation with a student. It's great to be using, you know, sort of short activities like cards and stuff. But talking to a student one-on-one, you can really have that direct dialogue that we've been talking about in the most direct possible way. I think this can be sort of just 5 minutes, even maybe with each student over the course of a month or over the course of 2 months. It can help you do lots of things. But one thing I've used these for is to set sort of one short-term goal and then one long-term goal. So that, for example, if we're doing tutorials every month, say, students could make a goal for that month, and then we could kind of revisit that goal after another month. And they're also, if they make a long-term goal, we can kind of revisit that long-term goal as well and sort of see where they are in reaching that goal, and sort of maybe think about how they could sort of reach you a little bit faster, a little bit more effectively. So at one of the key principles that we talked about at the beginning of the session was getting students to sort of monitor their own progress through sort of self-assessment. And that's sort of one of the tenets of formative assessment. So one thing they talk a lot about, because if we can get students sort of assessing themselves, that gives them the ability to do kind of a lot of the teacher's work for them when you think about it. So sort of a classic example is writing. So I think that often we give our students writing and then they give it back to us. We give them some written feedback or a mark and then we sort of carry on. And I think, at least in my own experience, that feedback isn't always kind of taken on board. I don't know if you've had the same experience. You sort of spend a lot of time correcting something, giving students some useful feedback, and then they don't seem to have read it or don't seem to have really sort of absorbed it the next time they do a writing. And one way of sort of improving that situation, maybe not fixing it, but improving that is giving students a checklist to do while they're writing something. So I've created a sort of simple one for an essay. if you do this, you're kind of doing two things. You're giving the students a way of kind of expecting or predicting their own mark on something. So if they've sort of ticked most of these boxes, they should have done, you know, quite well. They haven't ticked all the boxes, then, you know, they can kind of expect that maybe, you know, their mark isn't going to be quite so high. And it's also giving the students a way of kind of self-obsessing and maybe changing things along the way. So for example, if they write their essay and then they look at the checklist and they say, oh no, I forgot about the introduction and the conclusion. And then they go back and they sort of write it again with an introduction and a conclusion. So instead of basically the teacher telling them that kind of thing after they've finished, they're able to sort of do that themselves along the way. And hopefully by doing so, they're sort of incorporating that sort of success criteria in a way that they might not be doing otherwise. So obviously it's sort of an extension and activity of this. So once you get students using your checklist, you can get them creating their own checklist. And this is, you know, a way of getting them to take a little bit more responsibility. So for example, maybe you create a checklist for the article, the essay, but now you're doing an article and you're saying, okay, so we saw the checklist for the essay. An article is similar, but different. Let's think of a checklist that we can make for the article. And then students sort of make their own checklist and then they actually use it themselves to sort of self-assess while they're doing the activity. So I think the checklists work particularly well with writing, but you can get a checklist for almost anything, a presentation, a project. Checklists are sort of a simple, powerful tool within education, but also without sort of outside of education as well. When they implement things like checklists in hospitals, for example, less patients get wrong medications, but because if you have a checklist that you're going through, it reminds you of important things that you may have sort of missed. So the final idea that I wanted to talk about is a peer assessment activity. So it's obviously important for students to be self-assessing in order for them to take sort of responsibility for their own learning. But I think that the next step for that is peer assessment, getting students to assess each other. So they could be using, for example, checklists to do this or rubrics sort of that are simple enough for students to be able to use. And I think that sort of peer assessment is it's very useful because, again, the students are doing kind of a lot of the work that you would have to do. For one thing, if you have very big classes, it's hard to give students enough feedback on everything. But if students can be giving each other useful feedback, it's going to save you time and there's sort of more feedback sort of happening in class, more feedback happening during the course. The more sort of information students are getting about their learning and sort of how they're doing, the better. So we can take the example of a piece of writing. So the idea would be to give students some criteria to work with, maybe a checklist. And then it's important to have them go through certain steps. Because basically, in my experience, it's sort of human nature that when you're given another student's work, you kind of naturally just focus on what's wrong. And using this type of what's called a ladder of feedback, it's based on some research from a couple of researchers at Harvard. And if you kind of go through these steps, you're making sure the feedback is constructive. It's not sort of overly negative. So you'd get students to think about what they didn't quite understand by asking questions. And then second, sort of talking about what they liked, what they thought was done well. So I like how you use paragraphs. I like how you use topic sentences, that kind of thing. And then next, you would move on to some type of sort of negative, maybe criticism, talking about things that you think could be a little bit better, or things you're worried about. And finally, maybe most importantly, that you're not just sort of criticizing things, but you're giving suggestions or advice. And when you think about it, that's really good training, actually, because out in the real world, it's not particularly useful when people just criticize things without giving some type of suggestion or advice for how it could be improved. I think sort of in general, we could all be a little bit better about that. And within this sort of peer feedback, I think it's a really important step to make sure the students are doing. So that's kind of the end of the session in terms of the practical part. I just want to quickly revisit these core principles, just to kind of remind you that the sort of simple activities that I talked about today, they're just kind of the tip of the iceberg in terms of formative assessment. You can kind of, if you kind of have a formative assessment mindset, if you're keeping these principles in mind, you start seeing sort of lots of opportunities for maybe incorporating a bit more a formative assessment into your sort of classes and into your courses. So I would really encourage people maybe think about where sort of the opportunities are. And maybe start thinking about maybe integrating a little bit more formative assessment bit by bit. One thing they talk about with formative assessment is the importance of variety, so that you're not just doing sort of one type of formative assessment, because that's only giving you one type of information. It's better to have sort of a variety of activities, and that way you are getting sort of a variety of different types of information that will hopefully be useful to you while you are sort of deciding what to teach next and think about how to adjust your teaching. So before we move on to the question and answer, I wanted to do sort of a little exit ticket type of activity here at the end, and just get you to think about which sort of ideas about formative assessment or which sort of individual activities that I've talked about today do you think are going to stick with you, that you think that maybe you'd like to try to implement when you go back to your schools or to your universities or your private language schools, wherever you're teaching. So one person mentioned Mentimeter, checklists, people like checklists. I've had quite a people say learning journals. That's great. Learning journals are really cool. I do recommend them. It makes traffic lights, exit tickets. Great. So it seems like just about everyone got something out of this session. And that's actually one thing I wanted to mention here at the end, that one really nice thing about finishing your lesson with a bit of formative assessment, basically revisiting what students learned during the lesson, it actually makes you feel really good as a teacher. So obviously it makes me feel good to see all these people saying that they found some of the activities interesting or useful. And you will obviously have that same experience in class. So if your students in that sort of exit ticket activity, they say, oh, I learned this, I learned that, I learned this. Yeah, it makes you feel like you were an effective teacher, and that's good for our motivation. We need to think about staying motivated ourselves as well. With that, we can start with the question and answer. I haven't paid as much attention to the chat box as I was planning to, so I think there were some questions that I missed along the way. But it's not, I think Nathan has probably identified some of the good ones there. So Nathan, if you want to come back on, maybe I can stop sharing my screen and we can just chat.
Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you just fine.
Perfect. Ethan, thank you very much. That was absolutely brilliant. I think I learned quite a lot from that as well. And there's an outpouring of love in the chat box at the moment. I can see it all coming through. Thanks so much. Lots of practical stuff in there for teachers just to get going with formative assessment in their classrooms. I have been going through, I got my pen and paper here. I've been making little notes as I've been going. I've got some of my own questions and comments, and there's been a ton of them in the chat box and the Q&A box as well. So we probably won't have time to address them all, but I definitely think there are some good ones that we can. I'll give you a moment. I think people are still writing in some of their comments.
Okay,
have yourself a drink of water.
I don't have air conditioning in my flat, unfortunately. So I think the temperature is gonna go up during the day.
Take a moment for yourself. Focus on that well-being.
Yes.
Okay, I will give you the first question. So, should formative assessment be planned for, or can it be responsive, or can it be a bit of both, I guess?
I think it should be planned for. It can certainly be responsive. I think that the part of formative assessment that should be responsive is sort of taking on board what you've observed, what you've sort of taken note of, and actually acting on it. That part of it should definitely be responsive. But I think it pays dividends to incorporate this into our lesson plans and sort of plan to do it. Because I think it's easy to forget, you know, like you teach something and you've given the students the cards and stuff, but then you actually forget to ask them to use the cards. So I think that sort of maybe writing it down on your plan, that can be useful, at least in my own experience.
Yeah, planful, definitely. Yeah, but I think there's scope for some responsiveness if you think things come up during a lesson and you think it's going to be, there's an opportunity to help a student push their own learning forward or take responsibility. Then yeah, I think there's definitely a lot of scope for that.
Yeah, like advice and suggestions, of course, that's something we should always be doing throughout our courses, throughout our lessons, for sure.
Yeah. Not so much a question, perhaps this, but more of a comment. So when we think about assessment in schools, I think that the challenge for a lot of teachers, certainly here where I am in the Middle East and North Africa, but I would say across the world, is that there's this culture within learning that students just want to know what's needed for on the test. How can we break down that culture? Does formative assessment help us to do that? Do you think?
Yes. So I think that's actually a good place to start, because students want to know how to succeed, you know, they want to know what's on the test so they can study it, you know. And so if students have that desire to sort of understand how they're being assessed, I think that's a great place to start. And I think that, for example, using something like checklists or maybe rubrics that sort of very clearly explain how the students are going to be marked on something, I think it's just a natural thing to be talking about students, and students are usually pretty interested in, you know, they as you said, they want to know what's on the test. So if you're giving them something sort of skill-based, like a speaking activity or a writing activity, sharing the assessment criteria essentially with them in sort of a student-friendly, sort of student-fronted way, I think is a great way of encouraging sort of self-assessment. And then you could use that sort of understanding of the assessed criteria to do some peer assessment before sort of the final assessment happens.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, because I had a question actually that was very similar to the answer you've just given, which was, do you recommend having them practice with a rubric for writing so they can understand what they're going to be doing in a piece of writing before they go on to do an assessment using that particular rubric? Do you think teachers are afraid sometimes of giving students what might be seen as clues and hints and maybe even the answer sometimes?
Yes, yeah. Yeah, no, I think that's always a concern in a way, but I think it's also us kind of wanting to be in control of stuff all the time as well.
I agree, yeah.
If sort of the assessment criteria is a little bit mysterious, then we're the only ones with that mysterious information, you know, and that gives us an amount of power over our students. I think that has negative consequences, basically. If students are kind of surprised by their mark, it means that they probably didn't quite understand how they were going to be assessed, you know, what they had to do in order to succeed, you know, and that can be very frustrating and sort of disappointing. I think we've all had that experience as students ourselves. It doesn't feel good to be surprised on an exam. You know, exams shouldn't be surprising, really. There could be tricky questions on there, but they should be questions that should realistically be able to be answered, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I wholeheartedly agree. Totally agree. And I think it's difficult because there's sometimes a conflict between the systems and structures of schooling, you know, and these power structures that exist and what we want for students to be able to do. So there can be a conflict there. So perhaps that leads me on to another question then, which is actually one that I have. Isn't that about, you know, can students be involved in co-creating assessment? I would say both for themselves, but also for future learners. Can they take an assessment that they've just done and redesign it for the following year group, for example, or the following set of learners that come behind them? Do you think there's a lot of power in that?
Yeah, absolutely. Now, there's a new book that I read recently called Alternative Assessment or Activities for Alternative Assessment. And they have some very interesting ideas about doing just this, getting students to create rubrics for things, getting students to create checklists for themselves. Yeah, basically creating their own success criteria for a project or a presentation. And then, yeah, using that to sort of assess themselves as part of it. I think that has a lot of power. And I think that, for example, getting students to create like a model answer as well. So for example, like if you're gonna be using a checklist, you could get them to create like a couple examples, like one that's really good and one that's not so good, you know, so that they would, and they could share those examples with each other, and you could even use those examples for the next year, as you mentioned, so that students are sort of creating a way for themselves to actually sort of practice and apply the assessment criteria that you've shared with them. Yeah, I think that's a great idea.
Yeah, and then there's definitely some agreement in the chat box. I can see people coming up, Marina, in particular. We've got a few minutes left. You okay for a couple more questions?
Yeah, shoot.
Yeah, there are quite a few. You talked a little bit about learning journals, and I saw a lot of people in the chat when it came to what they took away from this session. Learning journals kind of popped out quite a few times. I agree. I think learning journals are a great activity to do with students. One of the questions that somebody had, I can't remember who it was, and it'll take me ages to find out who it was, but I'll just ask the question. Any suggestions on how to introduce learning journals? So in a lot of places, people probably have never done it.
Yes.
Teachers may not have tried it before. Students certainly don't know what it is and they're not used to that way. Any kind of tips to just get going with learning journals for those guys who do want to do it?
Yeah. I've found this to be true as well. Most of my students have never done this before. So I think that one thing that I did, I don't know if this actually makes sense or not, but I basically kept a journal myself of stuff that I had learned in Spanish, for example. So I was taking a Spanish course and I just took some notes about what I had learned in my Spanish course for a few weeks. And then I actually wrote it in Spanish. And then I shared that with my students and said, so this is basically the idea. Like I was going to Spanish class and then afterwards, I just quickly kind of reflected on what I had learned that day. I wrote down sort of the words, the phrases that were new for me. I wrote down things that I sort of found challenging, et cetera, et cetera. And it was actually in the student's own language and it wasn't perfectly written either. They very happily pointed out some errors. But I think that sort of, it sort of presented it in a very sort of like this is something that you know, everybody's on a learning journey, you know, your teacher's on a learning journey with their second language and you are too, and that I think they can kind of, I think if you give them kind of a concrete example of it, I think that that can help. If you're not comfortable with your students on language, or if you have multi sort of lingual classes, you could always just make some model examples for maybe a few days entries or something like that. So showing them, I think a model can be quite a positive way of introducing it, in my experience.
Yeah, again, I totally agree. And again, I've seen some things in the chat box, but yeah, involving students in the assessment process, making it meaningful though. And I know you also mentioned something about that during the webinar. If they don't take feedback on board, probably means that it's not very meaningful for them, either the process or the, could be the content, could be anything, I guess. So yeah, and I guess we've kind of run out of time, but I wrote down one thing on my little notepad, which was formative assessment isn't just to help the student understand their progress. It also really helps us teachers to make things better next time. I think that's a real power from formative assessments. And I think sometimes when we think about assessment, it's all individualized sometimes. It's all personal. You know, what did you like? What did you struggle with? And I think perhaps sometimes we can reframe that. So, you know, how would you change this so somebody else would succeed better, or how somebody else might enjoy it, or what do you think other people? So again, we can practice other empathy-based skills. It can bring in lots of things critical.
Actually, that's an activity that I've never tried before. That's really interesting. You can actually get the students to think, well, how? So I need to teach this class, this same lesson again next week. How could I teach it better? Like, well, what could I do that was, you know, how could I present this more clearly? What tools could I use that would be more interesting? That's a great activity. I like it. I'm right done.
Excellent. Awesome. Okay, we've got, before people leave us, we've got a couple of slides. Ethan, please feel free to stick around. Thank you so much once again. It was a fantastic session. I know you're gonna be back later today. Are you doing one more session or two more sessions?
Two
more sessions. So if anybody wants to come back and see this all again, you are more than welcome. Ethan, we will look forward to seeing you this afternoon. We have a couple of outro slides, so stick with us because there's a few points that we would like to make. If I can find them. Yes, perfect. Okay, so for those of you who have been with us with these webinars for quite a while, you probably would have seen our Insights Index program. We launched the Insights Index. It's a global research program. It's run by our own dedicated language research team. And it aims to work with practicing teachers. So you guys, there's 500-600 of you in the room at the moment. Our aim is to work with you guys and jointly evolve teaching practices and the materials that we make here at Macmillan Education. So we're inviting you all to join us and have your say in the development in the future solutions, materials, webinars, all the activities that we do here at Macmillan Education. It can also we're trying to make it as beneficial for you guys as possible. So enhancing your professional development, you can earn certificates, and you can gain access to the results from surveys that we run, white papers. If you haven't seen Laura Patsko's white paper yet, certainly go to the Insights Index. I can't seem to say that word. Insights Index program on the Macmillan English website. It's fantastic. It's a white paper based on a piece of research that she did. And there's tons of tips, really practical things that will help you out in your classrooms. Thank you.